so much for the opportunity. I'm not going to share slides. I'm just going to speak about what we see right now in the industry here. So first of all, if we look at the whole area around construction, and we see the commitment that has been given around the world from government, it is a historical moment. I know we are going to a historical moment because of COVID, but if we see since beginning of the year, where Joe Biden's ensured that US rejoined the Paris Agreement, we saw beginning of the year, World Economic Forum in January, 75% of the conversation was around climate and the climate crisis that we all are facing. We see for a couple of weeks ago how Joe Biden gathered 40 of the world leaders to speak about how we unite a way can work on climate solutions. Every single day, every single minute around the world, there is announcement, there is conversations, there is conference, the webinars, not just speaking about sustainability across all the 70 global goals, but there's a dedicated focus around constructions, infrastructure, sustainable infrastructure, and also around net zero. So what does that mean? What are we talking about in respect to skills and how are we going to do this? What I often say to people is that even though we see all this great commitment coming out from companies about they want to become net zero by 2030, by 2045 or by 2050, that is a vision, but an implementation, if there's no implementation linked to that vision, it's really just a fantasy. And that is in the implementations that we need frameworks, we need tools, we need technology solutions, we need skill set, we need us as people to go in and really build the different solutions to build, to create that big change that we all are talking about. And before I go into the details around what that means, I also want to speak about the idea that you actually are creating a vision into 2050, because we don't know what we don't know. And right now, nobody knows how to become net zero by 2050. That is really, it's definitely not a linear development we're talking about. It's not something about doing more of what we're doing today. It's really about doing a totally 360 in how we are behaving, what we're working on, what we're creating, what we're building need to be changed. And that's where science fiction thinking and scenario planning is becoming more and more key for how we are going to build back better. So for 2 years ago, I came out with a science fiction book for the enterprise, and it's really to use that mindset. So when we are coming up with incredible solutions, that we make sure that we do it in a super visionary way. So what I normally say to people, when you give a vision to be net zero by 2050, imagine you are in 2050, and imagine that you then do a time trial back to 2021, and then you begin to do your planning. So if you start with that mindset, that also means that the jobs that we will have in 2050 or the jobs that we'll have in 10 years are definitely going to change to the jobs that we have today. But we should always remember that we are building on our existing skill set. So if we take the big net zero transition that all companies are standing in front of right now, all countries are standing in front of right now, we as human beings are standing in front of right now, we are talking about a transformation, a digital transformation. And if you narrow it into construction with this festival is about, we are talking about a digital transformation within construction. So the skills that we need to have, first of all, the skills you already have is key for you to add the additional new skills on top of it. The first thing you need to know about is really what does SDG means for the industry that I'm in. So if you're in oil and gas or in mining or in architect of buildings or infrastructure within transportation, what do the ESG and SDG means within that industry? And this is here that there's a number of frameworks which has been come out from UN, And I recently launched a framework which is called the SDG Ambition. And the SDG Ambition is a framework that is translating the 17 global goals into 10 business benchmarks, because the 17 global goals that UN came out with for a couple of years ago was really built for the governments around the world and not so much for the private sector. That's the reason why we went in and we did a translation of the 17 global goals into 10 business benchmarks. And the 10 business benchmarks, some of the very well known of them is the 1.5 up against the Paris Agreement. But those 10 business benchmarks is linked together with a framework which is called the SDG Implementation Framework. And the SDG Implementation Framework is a framework where you go inside the company and you say, we need to make sure we put our vision, mission into the all strategy and governance of our company. So this is where we talk about the company's value, the vision, the mission statement of the company. We talk about the governance of the company, how the company is structured. We talk about putting together the right boards, putting the right C-level. Make sure when you do recruiting into the company, which is, of course, important for you to know that when you recruit, and that's the reason why you see a huge demand today for people who know about sustainable infrastructure, who know about carbon reporting across all the different kind of industries. So there's a big, big need for this skill set. But still remember, you're building this on your existing skill set. Then what you will also see in company, back to the carbon reporting. What I normally say is that 2020 was the year, yes, COVID came, but it was also the year where sustainability became core for every single business around the world. And that means that for you to be, in this case, net zero, you want to go in and do measurement, and that is the carbon reporting. So there's a huge demand of skills within knowledge around the framework that is out, and also about how you do carbon reporting. The thing about carbon reporting is that we historically, and I have a background in technology, I worked for SAP for more than 21 years, and working with dashboard and reporting is nothing new. But what is new is that you are reporting in real time on sustainability. And we have not done that historically, because when we build solutions, sustainability was not the core of the way we were designing solutions and technology solutions and our dashboards. So right now there's a big demand in the market for people who understand the different sustainability frameworks, science-based target, the SDG implementation framework, the SDG ambition and other frameworks, and then to go in and do real-time measurement on it. When we then go to the middle part of the SDG ambition framework, this is where you get into the core of the business. And if you look into construction and we look at when we, for example, are building buildings or building railroads, or we're building, you know, infrastructure for transportation, this is where we need to go in and think about the material we use when we build, but also what we are building for, where we are transporting material from to do the building, how we do the building. There are tons of things of new questions that you need to ask yourself when you start that process. So the whole thing about sustainable infrastructure is being redefined right now. And that is where we talk about procurement processes, supply chain, building processes, like what are the requirements to the end product that we want to get out of this. And that's where you can say we still need the skill sets we have today, but we need additional skill set on top of that. And what I always think is the most key thing is that when we design things, when we produce things, when we create things, it needs to be with the ESG as design principles. Then there's the whole people management piece, where every single person needs to be trained on the skill set. They need to walk the talk around sustainability. With inside companies, you will find a chief sustainability officer with the taking care of the companies, how well they work with sustainability. But then you also, with the new role, is the commercial sustainability person, which the work that I do at Woods, where you can say, when you go to market, when you deliver projects, you do that in a sustainable way. And this is a growing role that you see across companies around the world. And then you need to make sure there is a link between the external facing sustainability activities and how you deliver, and the internal sustainability, which is the DNA of the company. Then we go to corporate finance. So in corporate finance, in construction, we see right now there's a huge, it's actually 95% of investment today coming from, you know, investors and for governance and so on, is a requirement that the investment go to project initiative that is supporting the ESG and the SDGs. So also in finance, there's a huge uptake now on the knowledge around sustainability. When we go to the third pillar of the SDG implementation framework, that is enhancing stakeholder engagement. And this is where I actually got a little bit surprised to see how rapidly the demand between two companies, that it is a demand that both companies act in a sustainable way. So when we received tenders at Woods, which is a huge engineering consultant company all over the world, it comes from Scotland. It is 160 years old, 45,000 people around the world, who is involved in construction and transportation and working with oil and gas and the transition of the oil and gas industry, and are working literally across all different kind of infrastructure projects and working a lot with UN and EU and governments. What we see in the tenders that we are receiving, we are seeing that it is a requirement that we as a company are sustainable, but also that we deliver in a sustainable way. And that means that all employees at Wood today, they have a strong ESG sustainability knowledge and background. And this is the transition that we see all over the world today. As I mentioned, I come from a tech background. And when I built SDG Ambition together with UN, we took 2 years, we did a very detailed mapping to the technology side, and we saw that there is a 35% technology gap if you go across all the 17 global goals. And if you go into clean tech, which is big within construction and the whole net zero agenda, there is a 70% technology gap. So right now, there is a big call for action to startups, to the startup ecosystem, to the software industry, to engineering companies like what I represent, to come up with clean tech solutions. Because even though you want to be a net zero company by 2045 or 2050, there are so much that still needs to be defined and built. I'm not talking about that the technology do not exist. We have incredible exponential technology at hand, but it is to design the solutions that is missing. So if you, from a skills perspective, are into technology, I tell you that that is a big, big opportunity right now in the market to come in with clean tech solutions, which is one of the areas that I'm very key on and are working heavily on. Then if you look at the whole area around sales and marketing, so in the sales and marketing era, we also talk about the next generation CMOs, the chief marketing officers, because you can say, because sustainability and net zero has become a CEO agenda, it means that there is a very close link between the chief sustainability officer and the chief marketing officer. And that will be an ongoing key alignment until the commitment that you have given have been fulfilled. And that is a long, long journey, because you know many of those commitments in construction industry go to 2050. And that's where we see that the marketing role in companies are changing. You are seeing that marketing stories coming out of companies in the construction industry is very much about public-private partnership, networks with NGOs, networks with cities, networks with governments. So for example, at Woods, we work with resilience shift, the resilient cities. We work with software companies like Google and all the different big software companies. We work with, we build collectively solutions. We go into cities and are building cross solutions with cities and with the different universities and the different companies within cities and the citizens of the city. So you can say there is a shift in the way you drive projects today. In the past, you were mainly working on one project with one client, but today you work in project in public-private partnership settings. So that means that the way you sell and the way you go to market and you do storytelling about your company in the construction industry are changing dramatically in a much more united way. The same thing is it with partnership and stakeholder relationships. It is interesting when we reflect on what it means to build back better and you do it in a united way. Before COVID, and you can say COVID have definitely accelerated all of us as human beings, but also as companies to be much more inclusive and work much more in big collaborations and also build solutions that is not just solution for our clients or our local community, but it's really solution that serve the better of humanity. And this is something that could have, I think, have educated everybody on that we can't leave anybody behind. We need to make sure that when we now go in and we are solving the climate crisis, that the climate crisis is something that is a global crisis, and we need to go in and help all over the world. Antonio, the Secretary General, came out Friday and said that to be able to solve the climate crisis, the more wealthy countries need to go in and really take responsibility for the more poor countries. So when we build solutions, we need to build in a global way and contribute in a global way. And that's where I want to speak about UN. So UN is for me, really, you can say, who do you really work for? And you can say, when I work for SAP and now work for Wood PLC, everything I do for UN. And what do I mean by this? UN is uniting the world. And so whatever you can say, you have your backpack, whatever you build software, wherever you are part of big constructions, initiative, anything you do is to do something to create a better humanity. So if you have that mindset in your own career, where you say, whatever you are data science or you're an engineer or you are more in sales or you are working with public-private partnerships, as long as your design principles is around the ESG, so you design for you have that in mind, you design in mind for creating a better world. As long as you do that, you make sure what you create is going to contribute in a much bigger way than you ever dreamed about. So you can say there's no doubt about it that right now there is so many opportunities and there's a big shift. You can say what COVID also have learned all of us is to go digital. You know, we have learned to work in other ways, using tools in other ways, thanks to all the great technology. You can actually say, and I don't know that there's a framework, but it's called Share of Life. Share of Life is that we literally are living on operating systems. So if you think about how Google is helping our daily life, how Amazon is helping our daily life, how Microsoft is helping our daily life because they are, Apple is helping our daily life, the way we pay, the way we communicate, the way we, you know, get our learnings, how, you know, universities are using the digital platform. We have learned during COVID to work and collaborate in a whole new way. And if you take that new way of working, which is a much more distributed where we can work anywhere in the world. If you think about that new working style and then think about that you design with the ESG in mind, and then when you look at this huge focus and drivers that is focusing on sustainable infrastructure coming from governments and coming from the private sector, the opportunity, whatever you are, whatever role you want to go into, there is incredible opportunity in front of us. And I would say also my career advice to all of you is that make sure you put your passion into your work. And I also think for many people going through COVID, there's been a lot of reflection about how can I contribute? What can I do? And take that with you now when we go into part of the world is in a post-COVID, part of the world is still not, but as we go into a post-COVID, after COVID world, take that with you, that when you work, when you contribute, that you do it for creating a better humanity. And the climate crisis that we have in front of us, it is a personal matter to all of us. It's something that is impacting we as human being. It's something that is impacting the next generation to come. It's something that we can, that is something we all need actively to be part of. The last thing I want to talk about is behavior. So right now we are going into the fifth industrial revolution, and that is called the behavior revolution. So right now, and that is an area that I would suggest that you also skill yourself up on, right now there's a huge focus on the intersection. If you take construction, if you take, for example, that you are changing a city, how a city is, you know, the buildings will be built with the right sustainable material, you're recycling the right way, that you will have an updated infrastructure related to transportation. If I look at Copenhagen, where I am right now, people are mainly getting around in the city on bikes, for example, and with electric cars. But if you begin to look at like changing the infrastructure, this is great when this happened, and this is government and private sector who are going to do this. But what if the individual person are not changing their behavior? What if the individual person are not requiring that when they move into a building or when they select a vehicle to be transported from A to B, that that is in a sustainable way? What if we as human beings are not changing our behavior? This is where we talk about the household. So there's an intersection between the behavior in a household and the intersection between private sector and the public sector. So we need to make sure, and that's the reason why the trend now with the fifth industry revolution is that there will be a lot of conversations. So when you say you want to become net zero, cities say we want to become net zero, but that is a collaboration. It needs to be collaboration. You can't keep the citizen out of that conversation. It needs to be in a collective way, because in the end, the choices we take every single day when we live in cities or we live at the countryside is impacting the behavior of the private sector and governments. And this is also where we need to see that when government come in with regulations, that it is the right regulations that are helping to change the behavior, so we actually are improving together, because in the end, it has an impact on our natural resources. And that's the reason why we see the climate issues that we have now, that the behavior historically, just like the last 30, 40 years going back, the behavior between the individual person and the private sector and the governance has actually brought us into a situation now where we need to find new energy resources. And so it's the next thing, and that's part of your skill set. And when you look at construction, everything is interlinked between the households and private public sector and the natural resources. So the fifth industrial revolution is about the behavioral revolution. Much more you'll begin to see on conversation on that topic. So I think that is what I will give to all of you at this festival. I will say it's a very exciting time now. And I would say coming from the tech sector, I think the fact there are so many clean tech and green tech solutions that need to be built, it's amazing to see the fact that there's such a big focus on construction, being an engineer in construction and be able to go in and redefine and build new things is an opportunity that you have in front of you right now. So thank you so much. I hope that was helpful.
That was amazing, Anne. Thank you so much. So many useful things in there. I know that it looks like people are being a bit shy on the Q&A. Just down at the bottom of your screen there is a Q&A button. Please ask that, because I know all of our students are on anonymity settings. I have a couple of questions for you, Anne. I know that you mentioned there, just sort of touching on it, that your background is in tech. Is that something that you think has led you to this point? Is that something that you think has helped you to get as involved in sustainability as you are?
Absolutely. And so when I started in tech for many years ago, for 21 years ago, you were just excited if you have a little bit of technology that you could run your business with. But over time, technology, there's a limit to what you could do with technology if you go back. But today you could do anything you want with technology. And so I moved to Silicon Valley for 8 years ago and saw the incredible thing that Silicon Valley is all about collaboration and innovation. And I began to see that that is the same thing you see all over the world, which is really facilitating public-private partnerships, that you can build great solution. And we are at a moment in time now where you can say you can do anything you want with technology. You have incredible minds all over the world. Connectivity is getting better, so you have so many minds to build. The thing is, just when you can do anything you want with technology, and let's go back to science fiction thinking, and we know that for science fiction movies, the Black Mirror and so on and so forth, you can also use technology for not good, not for good stuff. So I'm talking about using technology for good. So there is a shift happening now, even though the technology has been here for years now. The shift is that every single piece of technology that we use today needs to be redirected so you use it for good. And that's why I'm excited that I have a technology background, because when I talk about digital transformation, no matter if it is a construction industry or any industry it is in, I really see now that every single piece of technology needs to be revisited so they are doing it in a sustainability and for good way. I'm a board member at the World Humanitarian Forum in the Technology for Good part of what they're doing. And we have a lot of conversation around that technology for good is not just a nice to have for some part of your business. It is a key component of using technology. It's more or less, if you want to use technology, you can only use it if you do it for good. And then when I found out there was such a big technology gap, if you go in to become net zero, we kind of thought we built so much, right? But no, we built it based on design principles, which was about innovation, optimization, and efficiency. But we let out the most important thing, and that was sustainability and technology for good. That in all the 21 years I've been part of the big tech and done big implementation around the world, that design principles was not part of the conversation. And that's why we now need to see, and that's a call for action to the big startup community, and I'm trying to rally as much as I can, begin to build that big gap of technology solution that we have. Whatever, if you go into clean tech, into the construction industry, there's so much that needs to be redefined and built, right? It's incredible opportunity. And that's why what you are doing here with the Festival of Construction and Skill Set, we need this scenario planning, science fiction mindset to accelerate now and rethink things. We're not talking about linear improvement. We are talking about rethinking everything, right? And that is an exciting time. So I normally say to people, activate your inside sci-fi person. We all have it. Get it in action and begin to create and rethink, but from a sustainability perspective. Yeah.